Hey, everybody. Wow, that music is quite an introduction. And thank you to Yanni for his introduction. So like he said, my name's Emma. I work at Formidable. I'm based out of the Phoenix office. And today I'm going to be going through kind of a case study with you of how we are able to use some like very hyped up technologies right now, TypeScript, GraphQL, and hooks, to do something that maybe sounds a little bit less exciting, which is make a code base much more readable. But I'm hoping by the end of the talk, you will also be really excited about making your code base more readable, because you'll learn about all the benefits that it can provide to your team overall beyond the technology side of things. First, a little bit about me and Formidable. So Formidable is a Seattle, Denver, Phoenix, and London-based consulting company. We work with clients to build new products, improve existing ones, level up their teams, focusing in React, Node, GraphQL, cloud services, and kind of the extended React related ecosystem. I've been at Formidable since 2016. I started as a junior developer. Like Yanni said, I am now an engineering manager, and I co-lead the Phoenix office. And I'm recently also the lead of our developer relations program. And shameless plug to follow both me and Formidable on Twitter, because you can never really have too much content there. So back to readability. We've all had the experience of diving into, especially maybe a new code base or one that we haven't worked on in a long time, and having a really hard time parsing out what a piece of code is supposed to do. Maybe on a new code base, we're just familiarizing ourselves. On an older code base, maybe it's something we wrote and we just don't even remember writing or why we wrote it, what it's supposed to do in the app. And this code isn't readable. And no one really likes working in a code base where they don't know what's going on, where they don't find it readable. It makes people feel kind of isolated and demoralized. And that can cause losses in productivity as people kind of struggle to figure out what exactly is going on. They may feel reluctant to ask questions. They may feel like they should understand what's happening in the code. And so they kind of demoralize themselves and isolate themselves. And this hit to productivity causes missed deadlines. It's going to give you less wiggle room to work on catching up on tech debt or write proper documentation, which can then lead to future further losses in productivity. So kind of a little bit of a spiral of doom effect, if you will. And this can be compounded by the lack of morale that I mentioned earlier, as people aren't productive if they don't feel good about themselves. And so we saw the real kind of real-world impacts of this on a recent project that we were working on. It was the beginning of a push to drastically update and rewrite the existing code base for a major website relaunch. And it was an all-hands-on-deck situation within the company. So the core web team was pulling in developers from all across the organization who maybe hadn't ever worked with this code base before. They were familiarizing themselves. And they were having a really hard time digging into the code and understanding what was going on, which was causing a lot of frustration since they felt unproductive and stuck. Another issue that arose from the code base being so difficult to parse and people feeling like they didn't understand what was going on is that pull requests were languishing in review for days, but sometimes even weeks. And I think there were one or two that were up to like a month in review. And it wasn't like these were getting a lot of comments or feedback and just taking a while to actually get to final mergeable state. People just weren't reviewing them because they didn't know what was going on and they didn't feel like they could actually comment on whether or not this was a good change to the code base. They didn't know if it would introduce new bugs to the code. We actually didn't have a continuous integration process in place at this point. So that, you know, added an extra risk. So PR reviews just weren't happening. And despite this hesitance, there were a ton of bugs in the existing app. It was really hard to figure out what you were looking for or where it was, even if you knew like what the issue was off the top of your head when you encountered a bug. It was hard to know where to look. The kind of file structure of the code base itself was really complex. It was difficult to parse where props were coming from in a lot of components. There was a really heavy use of higher order components in this app, and that provided a layer of complexity that made it more difficult to just see where something was coming from in the first place. Data shapes weren't always clear. They weren't always consistent from different APIs, so it was hard to air handle clearly across the app. And I know that there are a lot of opinions out there over what constitutes readable code. And I knew this before I asked the question on Twitter, made that mistake, and I definitely knew after. So I want to be clear about what type of readability I'm talking about before I kind of go into the hows and whys. So to start, I'm going to set my definition. And my definition is an engineer who is generally familiar with the language and broader technologies being used in the project can understand what the code is accomplishing, largely or entirely on their own, within a reasonable amount of time. And I know that sounds really broad, but there's actually a huge difference between code that fits this definition and code that is really challenging to parse for someone especially new to the project. And luckily for me, Twitter seemed to generally agree with this definition, so that'll be okay when this talk hits the internet later. So, like I said, TypeScript, GraphQL, hooks, all very kind of buzzwords right now in the React community. And people are really excited about them for some very, you know, well-deserved technical reasons as well. But in this case, they provided us with some really valuable wins on the readability side, in addition to the technological wins that they gave us. So those are, that's not what I wanted to do. Whoops, okay. So the primary benefits there were built-in documentation, easier code-based navigation for developers, and cleaner business logic abstractions. And these were all really big wins on this project in particular based on where we were starting from with the original code base. So I'll go through each of these benefits, kind of some examples as to why they were so helpful with these specific technologies, and then talk about the wins that more readability in the code base provided for the team at large. So the first one is built-in documentation. This was one of the most valuable ways I feel like we increased readability in this particular project. So using TypeScript on the client side, we also used it on the GraphQL layer, but on the client side was where I felt we got the most value of it up front. We used it to document and enforce component APIs. So let's say you're working on an app that stores and organizes recipes for avid home cooks. So here's an example of a pretty simple component that takes in a recipe prop and renders it on the page with the title, the list of ingredients, the directions for how to cook it. So it's, like I said, fairly simple component. You'd likely be able to make some pretty educated guesses about kind of what those shapes of those props are, what types they are. But there are a few ambiguities, especially because like amount could totally be a string or a number. And what does directions return as? That's kind of broad. So here's that same component written in TypeScript. So you can see that we have the interface definition up here. It really clearly tells you that the title's a string, what the shape of the ingredients prop is. It's an array of objects. Amount is a string, we find out, as is the name of the ingredient. And directions is a simple string. In a real-world example, it would probably be multiple strings that then you would cobble together, but I didn't feel like going through the effort of setting that up for this. So we also know that it's the only prop being passed into the component. There aren't any, like, props that are now not being used from previous iterations of this component earlier. And while, like I said, you could have probably figured this out on your own, if you're working with a really complex component, especially within the confines of a much more complex app, having this information told to you right from the beginning is actually going to save you a lot of time. It'll come in like little, you know, chunks of time individually that it saves you, shaving off like a minute here, a minute there, but overall it adds up to give you a lot more time to work on other tasks that you're going to enjoy more than figuring out what exactly is going on in your code. And so on the data later, we are using GraphQL to kind of clarify and document the data mapping and the data model. So the documentation for the APIs on this project were not necessarily up to date. It wasn't always complete. So adding this kind of informal GraphQL documentation was really valuable. And so what that looks like is, let's say we have a JSON object called prep instructions, and it returns an array of recipes that you can cook. And here is, you can see that there are ingredient list IDs that are associated with an ingredient list for each one. So here's the one for the risotto. Onion, garlic, rice, chicken stock. And it's not, you know, it's classic like REST API situation where connected with IDs. But on the client, we're not calling recipes prep instructions. That's not the term that users are actually going to be looking for. We're calling them recipes. So the first thing we can do is indicate this kind of API to client mapping structure in our GraphQL model. So here, what we can do is I still prefer usually to call the actual fetch methods themselves something that replicates the endpoint name for clarity there. But then you're renaming it recipe list for what you will eventually pass on to the client. And you are in the resolver getting the ingredients list, which I'll cover a little bit more later. And here's the query, still using recipes, all the way to querying it from the front end. So that makes it really clear if you are starting with like recipe list from the client, trying to debug something, trace it back through from the front end query to the schema, to the resolver, to the model, and see, oh, this is coming from the fetch prep instructions like call. It's from the prep instructions endpoint. I see that the business logic here is dictating that prep instructions is being called recipes. And this was all enhanced with GraphQL code generator as well, which was a really valuable tool. And I'm not going to go too in-depth into how GraphQL code generator works, but what it does is you write a config file. It will take your GraphQL schema and queries and generate Apollo. Well, there's a lot of options, but we're using Apollo. So it'll generate Apollo query components that are typed based on what's in the schema. And that will correspond to your client-side type. So this makes it really easy for one developer to work on the GraphQL layer for a particular feature, and then another developer to pick it up on the front end with seamless integration on types between the GraphQL layer and the client. So that was super valuable. And if you want to learn more about GraphQL Code Generator, my colleague Stephen Musemesh wrote a really great article on the Formidable blog a few months ago that goes a lot more into depth on how that works. So I've linked that at the end of my slides, and I really recommend you check that out. So number two, easier code-based navigation. And the major win that we saw in this particular app was being able to replace lots of higher order component implementations with React hooks, which was really useful for clarifying where props were coming from within components, especially really complex ones. So an example of that is this component is getting all of these props back. And you can see down here, it's being wrapped by four separate higher order components. A couple of them are third-party libraries. A couple of them are hand-rolled utility functions. But at the end of the day, all of the props are coming back like this. And that might seem fine, and it's a very normal pattern. But it can make it really hard to figure out, if you're having issue with one of those props, where that original implementation of it is. Like, is it from a third-party library? Is it in another file? It just takes a while, again, adding up to time that you could be better spent doing something else. So here it is using kind of a hooks example instead, where you can clearly see which hook each prop is coming from. And in turn, you can see all of the files that those hooks are being imported from, which make it very simple saying, oh, we're having an issue with user settings. That's being imported from user settings utils, or you know, whatever the file would be named. So that ended up really clarifying a lot of stuff for us. We also got the benefit of using hooks once Apollo made hooks available in their client-side, their Apollo client, which was awesome, and also able to be integrated into GraphQL code generator. The other one, I won't go into too much depth here, but kind of like Sid pointed out in his presentation, especially if you're using VS Code, TypeScript really kind of like supercharges your text editor. It'll yell at you a lot, which is frustrating, but really good. Helps prevent bugs, helps prevent using the wrong type primarily. It also helps you know exactly where something was implemented, where it was originally defined. And it makes it really easy to refactor, because you can change an instance in one file and change it everywhere it's implemented across the entire code base, which made it super easy to rename stuff, which was awesome. And finally, the third one was like cleaner business logic abstractions. And I'll start by saying, that abstractions can be a double-edged sword. At their best, they really clarify business logic and make it really easy to reuse code. At their worst, they can be really opaque and over-engineered. So we really tried to stay, of course, in the first category there. And so I'm going to go back to the GraphQL resolvers to show an example of this. So we always want to return the list of recipe ingredients along with a recipe. And a resolver is a great way to do this because it handles it for you before the data ever hits the client. So that also documents whenever anyone's going back and looking through, oh, how do we get, you know, the recipe data up to the client side, we always return ingredients with a recipe. So that kind of dictates that business logic to whoever is reading this code for the first time without having to have separate documentation. Another thing for this is utility hooks, kind of write once, use in multiple places across the app. And this helps document business logic that's reusable as well, because if you're writing abstractions correctly and only writing them once they're actually being used in multiple places, this can really clarify like what important and reusable business logic is to anyone who's encountering that code. So, and the improvements and benefits that we saw on the team that were not technologically related, developer onboarding is much quicker for people now who are new to the code base. People can grasp the code much more quickly. It's instead of slowing down productivity whenever someone new is added, it actually speeds up the process, which is awesome and exactly what you want. And it's especially really useful for early career folks who are onboarding to the project because they get to feel ownership of the code much more quickly, and they get to get their first PR up much more quickly, and they feel really good about themselves, and that's great, and that makes them productive and happy. Got prompt and efficient code review. Code is no longer languishing in a PR for days or weeks. It's getting merged into the project, cutting down on merge conflicts. People feel comfortable reviewing someone else's code, which in turn makes it easier for them to then work in that part of the code base later on. Quicker bug tracking and fixing. It's easier to figure out where something's going wrong, find it, fix it, which is awesome. It's like I kind of mentioned earlier, easier for developers to pick up work across the code base if you're more familiar with what's going on in the rest of the code, because you're able to get good PR reviews. Because it's not impossible for you to figure out a piece of work that you haven't previously worked on. It makes everybody a lot more flexible. It increases productivity. And it makes people less, it makes people more sure of themselves overall. They feel like they understand the code base as a whole and not just individual pieces of it, which gives them greater ownership over the entire product. So everyone was a lot happier. Overall increased productivity and reduced frustration, which is what you always want on your team. So, not bad. And now's the time for the caveat section, which is that no technology is an automatic win, and while we are able to achieve these results with TypeScript, GraphQL, and hooks, all very hyped up technologies, you can do this with a lot of technologies, whether they're being hyped up right now or not. And the key is being intentional with your tools. Because it's totally possible to have a code base that incorporates all of these technologies and is an absolute mess. If you're using TypeScript, but typing everything is any, it's not going to do you any good. If you're using GraphQL as a one-to-one data layer with existing APIs, it's also not adding any value for you. It's just cruft. Hooks can also be really challenging to use in certain implementations. They're not always something that you should be replacing everything with. So the key is really just being intentional. Know what you want out of your tools. Look for ways that they can improve your project, especially readability. That's a very big win. As I mentioned for our team, what seems like such a basic thing can really add, like, you know, multiple dividends to your product, to your team, make everybody happier and more productive. So thank you so much for my talk. These are all the resources I was using. Like I mentioned, that blog post from Steven Musemesh. And then if you want to check out GraphQL code generator and stuff, I really recommend that you do. It's an awesome tool, and it's added a lot of value. And thank you so much for coming out to React Advanced and my talk.